very much, because as you know, our event, we're trying to keep the quality very high, and we also try to maximize attendance of the investment community. Without saying much more, I would kindly ask Chris Weatherby to come and say a few words. Chris has been our partner, has been sharing the heavy burden with us on, very well on this event. And then we will have Mario Cordero give us his remarks, and then we'll have lunch, and we'll proceed with the rest of the program. So Chris, thank you again for your partnership and for all your help.
Thanks, Nicholas, appreciate it. So for those that don't know, I'm Chris Weatherby. I'm the Senior Transportation and Shipping Analyst for Citi, and it is my pleasure to be partnered with Citi, with Capital Inc. again for the second year in a row on the Shipping Forum. You know, Nicholas and I have known each other for a long time. We got together last year to work on this this forum for the first time with Citi as a main sponsor. You know, I really thought this was a premier event in shipping. I think we've absolutely seen that continue here with our second year. I always like to throw out some numbers, so I'm an analyst, you have to bear with me here on this. So just to put it in perspective, this year versus last year, we've added 20% to the companies that we're hosting one-on-one meetings for. So there certainly has been interest. And in addition to that, we've booked 35% more meetings with those 20% greater companies. So clearly there is a greater investor interest this year versus last year, and I think we can see reasons why. I don't know if anybody was able to catch the dry bulk panel this morning. It certainly took me back to sort of 10, 12 years ago when I first started covering this sector. It was awfully bullish. Maybe a touch too bullish, but we'll see how that sort of plays out. Hopefully I'll be proven wrong in that respect. But ultimately, you know, the last couple of years have been a bit of a bumpy ride within the shipping markets. But at Citi, we remain committed to it, remain committed to Capital Inc. as a partner for this. From myself, my colleagues on the investment banking and the lending side, you know, we're here and we want to make sure that we're still playing a big part in this role. Like I said, this is a premier event in shipping. We're very pleased to be doing so. Thanks again for coming. I'm not going to stand in the way of everybody in their lunch and the speakers that are much more interesting than me, but thanks again for coming. Appreciate it.
Well, Chris, thank you for the good words. Before introducing the Federal Maritime Commissioner, I just want to say, if you allow me, a tremendous thanks to my clients who have been with us for a long time, and their support is exactly what enables us to continue. So thank you very, very much for being with us, and of course to all of you, because I have to confess, this year number 11 we're holding this event. Every year it's a great event. And I'm so grateful to see the quality staying so high. I'd like to acknowledge also that we have with us today the Minister of Transport, Communication and Works from Cyprus. 5% of the global fleet is managed out of Cyprus, so Minister Dimitriadis is with us today, and we're delighted to have him with us. And I would like to ask the Commissioner Mario Cordero to join us and deliver his remarks. We are really privileged to have him with us. He has been the commissioner since 2011, and through under his leadership, the Federal Maritime Commission has been completely restructured, new programs, new mentality. So I would like to, you know, far-reaching developments, and I think given where we are today, we couldn't have a better and more timely presence than the Federal Maritime Commissioner, Mario Cordero. So thank you for being with us. And by the way, I'm trying to convince him to come with us to China in May.
Thank you, Nicholas, for the great introduction. I'm very honored to be here. Here, not only with Capital Link in its 11th annual International Shipping Forum, but in this great city of New York. I'm from California, the Los Angeles area, Long Beach specifically, but in the last couple of years I reside in D.C. So the weather conditions in California are a whole lot better than in New York, of course. But I'd like to say also with regard to the conditions with regard to international trade. I wish I could say it's a whole lot better like the weather in California. But I think I can say that we'll get there. It'll get better. And I think one of the things that I heard earlier, I think in terms of the investing community, absolutely the shipping community needs you, the international shipping community, and I think there is light at the end of the tunnel. Clearly the international shipping community has had some rather serious challenges in this last decade. Number one, going back to the 2008 economic global recession, had a severe impact on international maritime transportation carriers who continue to struggle with unsustainable transportation rates. And then second, we now have what many today term as the geopolitical recession, evoking a global dialogue on protectionism and isolationism. But before I speak more about this issue, let me tell you a little bit about the Federal Maritime Commission. Because I think the most common question I'm asked is, who is the FMC and what do you do? I currently serve as a commissioner and was past chairman. The FMC is an independent regulatory agency responsible for regulating the U.S. international ocean transportation system for the benefit of U.S. exporters, importers, and the consumer. We do this by fostering fair, efficient, reliable movement of competitive international ocean transportation systems and protecting the public from unfair and deceptive practices. But I think what you've seen of the FMC in the last several years, we're not so much a regulatory-focused agency. I think we're more about facilitating the movement of cargo and facilitating international trade. And the FMC does this in so many ways, but let me tell you some of those ways. We monitor activities of ocean common carriers, marine terminal operators, and ports that operate in the U.S. foreign commerce to ensure just and reasonable practices. Two, we review competitive activities such as rate discussion agreements, carrier alliances, and other agreements among marine terminal operators and carriers. Three, we maintain trade monitoring, enforcement, and dispute resolution programs to assist regulated entities in achieving compliance and to detect and remedy unreasonable practices and violations of the shipping act. In essence, we are the federal agency that is responsible for monitoring containerized shipping for the benefit of American commerce. Now, the FMC traces its roots back to the 1916 Shipping Act signed by President Woodrow Wilson. The legislation established the United States Shipping Board, which is the founding agency from which the Federal Maritime Commission is derived from. The impetus of that legislation was a concern among policymakers about the state of the American maritime industry. With its passing back in 1916, Congress sought to achieve two goals. Number one, to reinvigorate the U.S. merchant marine, creating a merchant marine fleet capable of meeting the nation's defense and trade requirements. And second, to regulate the foreign and domestic shipping to ensure competitiveness and protect the interests of shippers and consumers. Both of these objectives were achieved through the work of the then Shipping Board. In 1917, the United States entrance into World War I, the U.S. Shipping Board undertook an ambitious vessel construction program to establish ocean-going tonnage sufficient to support the transportation and supply of the American troops overseas. Now, I give you this historical perspective because I believe the time has come in the United States to once again invest intelligently and generously into its maritime transportation system. I suggest that questions of competitiveness and protecting the American shipper are key concerns today as they were back in 1916. Today, international trade is an integral and critical part of the U.S. economy. More than the nation's GDP is tied to global commerce, and this figure is only projected to become, or predicted, I apologize, to become more significant in the coming years. Ocean transportation of goods and commodities is the backbone of our trade system, and your FMC ensures that exporters and importers enjoy access to international maritime carriage services. Indeed, vessels carry 53% and 35% of U.S. imports and exports respectively, and 90% of world trade moves by way of vessel. As a nation, we need to continue to invest in maritime infrastructure at our ports in order for our ports to become more efficient, cleaner, and sustainable with the capability of receiving today's mega vessels. And then we can then apply the cost savings to areas such as technology. About a year ago, March 15, 2016 to be specific, I testified before the Congressional Subcommittee on the paramount concern of having a well-funded and well-resourced Federal Maritime Commission. I explained that the FMC's statutory mandate to regulate international ocean transportation system for the benefit, as I stated, for domestic exporters and importers was ever more important in this decade, second decade of the 21st century. I noted that the international trade accounts for approximately one-third of our GDP, and many economists forecast that by 2029, international trade will approximate two-thirds of our GDP. In sum, in my testimony, I emphasize that international trade is a significant component of the American economy. However, today, a year later, many in the international trade community have grave concerns with not only the domestic debate questioning the benefits of international trade, but also the global debate. Let me make clear, international trade is a two-way street. Exports are as important as imports. True, there may be an imbalance of the export-import formula or equation, and I, of course, support any way and opportunities to maximize U.S. exports. However, at the end of the day, the success of U.S. exports and manufacturing is dependent on a global consumer, not just a domestic consumer, a global consumer. For example, agriculture and grain commodities are a large component of future U.S. export growth. In January of this year, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, as an example, noted that significant growth in beef and pork exports for January 2017, highlighting a year-to-year increase of 18% in beef and 26% in pork. And by the way, Mexico is the leading destination for U.S. pork. I thought I'd throw that in since I'm of Mexican-American heritage, for those of you who are wondering. So, on the oil and gas side, we see exponential growth in LNG exports. Within the next 3 years, the U.S. may be the third largest export of LNG, coupled with the projected increases in exporting American crude oil. Our nation is moving forward for positive growth in domestic energy. Overall, 2016 ended with a growth in containerized exports, though modest, an increase of 1%. However, growth in containerized exports was the first in 3 years. And the value of those exports transported by vessel in 2016 was in excess of $475 billion. Before I conclude my commentary on international trade, I want to provide you a few statistics on U.S. and global performance in trade in 2016 and 2017, or forecasting. I should note that in January, the International Monetary Fund estimated that 2016 global growth was at 3.1%, and forecasted 2017 to grow at 3.4%. Last month, Alphaliner forecasted global growth for 2017 at 1.7%, and I note that IHS Market Consultants calculated the continued export growth to be at 2.5% in 2016 and predicts those exports to expand in 2017. Regarding imports, IHS also determined that imports were up 4.3% in 2016, making the seventh year of growth of U.S. imports. Looking forward, IHS expects a 6% expansion of imports in 2017, also compared to the U.S. national retail Federation's prediction of 4.7% of the first half of 2017, which will total, if those predictions are correct, will be 21.8 million containers, or TEU containers as we refer to them. If these last predictions are correct, there would be the higher rates of growth than in recent years, particularly over the last 4 years. Growth in container ports has emerged far or from a range between 1.4 and 2.9%. Finally, according to IHS Market, the U.S. real GDP growth will rise somewhere in the rate of 2.3% in 2017. Now, I highlighted these statistics, again, to make the point that international trade is a vital component to our nation's economy, and the success of American enterprise is dependent on a global consumer. Let me touch on the whole question of carrier alliances, which I believe the FMC has had a lot of write-ups on this. Is perhaps one of the most significant developments in the international shipping community is that of carrier consolidation. In the year 2011, which is the year I joined the Federal Maritime Commission, we had approximately 21 major global water transportation carriers or containers. Today, essentially we will have 2013, which will account for 70% of containerized global capacity, each belonging to one of three alliances that set to commence in April of this year. And those two alliances are as follows. The 2M Alliance, the Ocean Alliance, and the Alliance. And frankly, I'm not sure whether we will see the end, or we've seen the end of carrier consolidation. In fact, consultants, Sea Intelligence Consulting, they've indicated that perhaps by 2025, we're going to be down to 6 to 8 major international container carriers. Now, the alliance agreement between these carriers was filed with the FMC, and essentially there are vessel sharing agreements, motivated by economies of scale. The carriers focus on achieving cost savings given the challenge in securing a sustainable transportation rate. The vessel sharing alliance concept is nothing new. However, the current level of debate and scrutiny within the industry with regard to these carrier alliances really commenced with the filing of the P3 Alliance. And that filing was back in 2013, an alliance between the three largest carriers in the world, Maersk, Mediterranean Shipping, and CMA CGM. That agreement, or that alliance, was ultimately pulled back because of the veto that was exercised by China's regulatory agency, the Ministry of Transport. And the parties then came together as two, that is Maersk and MSC, and proceeded to file the 2M Alliance. And again, these carrier alliances for the purpose of achieving economies of scale by the major transportation carriers. So the question for the maritime industry and the community of the supply chain is what is the impact of these alliances to the supply chain? I believe they will result in cost savings and efficiencies. For carriers, cost savings is a paramount concern, especially given the need to invest in cutting-edge technology. So one thing about the shipping industry, particularly the carriers, they've been behind the eight ball in terms of putting in place the type of 21st century technology that is needed. Although I'll comment more on that as I will conclude, but that's changing. So the P3 agreement really brought forth some very legitimate concerns on part of this debate. And those were the fact that we started to see the aligning of operation centers that the alliance members would compose, conducting business at arm's length, which potentially would have information sharing. Another concern that is violative of the antitrust laws. And also this whole issue of joint contracting authority has appeared in many agreements filed within the last 2 years. This authority usually allows all members of the alliance to negotiate as one entity with a service provider or a third-party vendor. And the concern I have with this authority is the potential power imbalance during negotiations with domestic harbor providers. Would a single service provider be forced to accept the alliance terms, or would it be forced out? This is, again, it's a question with regard to competition, but at the end of the day, I think these cost-effective measures are necessary within the carry industry. 2016 brought some generational changes, as I referenced, with regard to this whole issue of consolidation. The French company CMA-CGM purchased Singapore-based NLL-APO. China Ocean Shipping, Costco, and China Shipping consolidated into one line. Hapag-Lloyd acquires United Arab Shipping Company. Hanjin, one of the top carriers in the world, files bankruptcy. The three Japanese carriers, something that many people believe would never happen, decided to consolidate their carrier industry. MOL, K-Line, and NYK announced this joint venture. And the government of Taiwan moved to shore up carriers with loan assistance. And last, 2016 ended with Maersk purchasing German-based Hamburg Süd. The international shipping industry will continue to evolve, whether as to structure, service delivery, or cost-saving efficiencies. In 2017, I believe we will have an escalation of a number of digital and e-commerce applications with the objective of providing more visibility in the movement of containerized freight and implementing cost-effective solutions in the supply chain. Allow me to elaborate on industry progress on the incorporation of technology. You know, one of the issues about this global debate of international trade and the impact, particularly what we're talking about in this country, is the impact on jobs. And I think the reality is that the real impact has been more about technology, not so much about international trade. But nevertheless, the February 17 issue of Global Trade reports that both Amazon and Alibaba are starting to establish themselves as movers of cross-border freight. Indeed, Amazon recently announced its intention to becoming an NVOCC. This is not to say that they will own or operate vessels. However, I note that many carriers are implementing close links to cloud-based supply chain specialists like Intra, GDT Nexus, Carnival Smart, who are all early adopters of e-commerce. Currently, much of the focus in technology and containerized trade is in tracking logistics, such as real-time information in container movements. These advances further visibility and transparency in shipping. Recently, the Journal of Commerce reported that Maersk and IBM are teaming up to digitize the global container supply chain using the technology of blockchain technology to improve efficiencies and costs. This technology will result in enhancing visibility to partner with e-commerce entity Alibaba to integrate transportation and logistics. Actions such as these can reduce costs and improve reliability of supply chain systems. And recently, we've seen the New York Shipping Exchange launch a pilot online portal to book and monitor booking fulfillment. Likewise, the Panama Canal will be launching a new vessel scheduling and maritime resource system, essentially being an appointment system. This system will be used to streamline and schedule transit operations, including critical service providers such as tugboats, pilots, and line handlers. And in fact, this is something I've been talking about with regard to the need to streamline and put technology in place on our marine terminal operators so that we have people who use those gates more efficiently and timely so that we don't have a backup in cargo and getting out of the terminal operations, whether that be in New York or that be in Los Angeles. By implementing these new systems, shippers should be able to experience increased reliability and shorten vessel waiting times. Undoubtedly, these advancements in technology I discussed here with Amazon, Alibaba, and the New York Shipping Exchange, and for that matter, Panama, will help to reduce costs in optimizing resource allocation in the international shipping industry and the trend of what we're seeing today. These are only a few examples of the migration of advanced technology and e-commerce platforms. I will conclude with this. I generally believe these are interesting times in this industry, to say the least. But I think there's ample room for optimism. Once we understand and agree on the American importer-exporter role in international trade, and the international trade's significance in the role in American commerce, and once we can focus on the ways to promote all three, I strongly believe in promoting the American importer-exporter and international trade and American commerce means investing in our American maritime infrastructure, including the FMC. And finally, to again have a sense of optimism here, you know, those of you who may know or who are historians, history teaches us one thing. And there was a book that I read of an author who I met in Washington a year and a half ago who wrote a book entitled The Sea and Civilization. That's all about international trade and the movement of cargo going back to the beginning of civilization. And essentially the theme and the conclusion of the book is international trade has nowhere but to go up. And that's where we're at today in this world. I don't see anything changing. True that we have some significant debate on some legitimate concerns. But I think with the cohesiveness of the shipping industry and with the investors in terms of, at the end of the day, what are we gonna see in the future? I hope we do see great things. So that's my quasi-optimistic message to you all. Thank you so much for your time. And again, thank you for those of you in the investment and finance industry for taking a good look at the international shipping and the optimistic components in terms of what it may bring. So thank you so much again.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm not quite sure what to say after such a nice introduction, but I want to thank Capital Link and Citi who have asked me to come and share my insights on the global shipping industry. So I've only been retired for about 6 weeks, so I haven't hopefully lost too much of it. But I especially was pleased to come today because I get the chance to share the lectern with some distinguished luminaries, including one gray-haired one, Rich DeMoulin, who we're honoring today, and who I think is richly deserving of this award. So, Rich, let me do the first. So in the spirit of famous gray-haired people, I thought I would invoke Albert Einstein, who famously said, "If I had 1 hour to save the world, I would spend 55 minutes defining the problem and only 5 minutes finding the solution." So lucky for you, I don't have an hour. Instead, only about 15 minutes to talk about the state of the global shipping industry. But I'm going to try to use the same ratio that Einstein had in mind. So working through my checklist, does the shipping industry deliver safe and efficient transport of goods? Let's talk about safety first. Check. The industry has made huge progress and continues to make great strides in lowering its lost time injuries, reducing environmental pollution, and of course, most importantly, the improvements that have extended to the shipyards. In fact, we're even getting better in ship demolition. Efficiency. Yes, the industry, as the commissioner points out, moves over 90% of international transport, but no, I'm here to tell you that I don't think that we run our business efficiently, and I'll return to that subject. The second point, does it earn a decent rate of return for providing transportation services around the world? No, and therein lies one of the first problems of sustainability. Three, is the industry susceptible to disruptive technologies? Yes, and I think it's more than most people in this room realize, and therein lies another problem of sustainability for the shipping world. More about that in a minute, but I think that things may change rather quickly and rapidly in the future, in the next few years. When I joined Teekay as CEO 5 years ago, I said I think it would change more in the next 5 years than it had in the previous 10, and I think that proved correct. And when Kenneth Vitt, who took over from me, came in, I said, it's only gonna accelerate, Kenneth. And I think that our industry is gonna change rather rapidly, much as we see today in autos and in trucks. So the fourth is, where are we in the state of ocean freight transport now? Well, shipping is what we call a late cyclical industry. And right now, It looks like we're coming out of, finally, the hangover that we and the world sustained in the financial crisis, which is coming up on its 10-year anniversary in 2018. So when you travel around the world, here we have lots of different names for it, but in Europe and especially Australia, they call it TFC. And they've just got that acronym, the financial crisis. Well, for us, as a lot of you in this room know, a lot of demand was lost in the TFC. In tankers, when in 2008, we were transporting about 44 million of the 84 million barrels consumed, we lost about 10% of that oil that was transported at sea. And it hasn't come back really to the US or Europe. In dry bulk, we lost a lot of cargo as commodity prices dove lower. So it was very interesting that we saw iron ore transport at record levels, but coal transport is still seeing declines. So overall, it isn't a good picture. If someone had told me that you would have record iron ore exports from Port Hedland in Australia and record iron ore exports from Brazil and asked me to say what would Capesize rates be, it would start with a 2, as in 20,000 to 30,000. So what a surprise, not even a year ago, to see it at $2,000 a day. And that is, of course, a function of coal. But now in dry bulk, I wasn't here for the panel this morning, we're seeing some amazing turnarounds. But for me, it starts with the prices. So iron ore, over $90 last week, and met coal being up almost 100%. These are good times that will flow down to shipping. So it looks like we're finally coming out of the long trough caused by the TFC. So where are we today? Well, I've shared a few panels with Martin Stopford, and I think Martin has it right. Martin likes to talk about how, and contrast where we are today with 1966, 50 years ago. So Rich, you're somebody in the room who can understand this, clearly. He makes parallels between today and then. If you go back to 1966, you had containerization, which was about to eclipse tramp and traditional pallet shipping, which dominated liners. Indeed, it began the era of specialized ships, which totally annihilated general cargo shipping with its multi-decks and inefficient port time. In 1966, the first VLCC was delivered, and today we have specialized carriers everywhere. Car transport, forestry transport, newspaper transport, and so many different kinds of bulk transport sizes. So the ends of the 60s and 70s also saw the end of the time charter. As the surplus of ships caused cargo owners to forego time charters in favor of spot charters. Obviously the greatest example of that was, of course, crude oil tankers. But if we fast forward to today, we see it happening in LNG, where the surplus of ships and changing technology of the ships means that the LNG cargo owners are foregoing or shortening the long-term contracts that have traditionally been part of that. So we're seeing specialized ships lose their long-term contracts. And I haven't even gotten to liner transport. So let's talk a little bit about liner transport. Sea trade growth is clearly slowing, and we're seeing a regional trade change away from the OECD toward non-OECD. So once we had 5% world GDP growth, but as the Commissioner Cordero says, now we have a much lower, 2.5%. And that, of course, hurts world trade, which was a multiplier. So lots of folks like to talk about the Silk Road Renaissance. That is to say, the land transportation of goods from China to Europe through Russia. And I think that's interesting, but I want to talk about something that Commissioner Cordero brought up, which I think is far bigger. Something that he brought up, but may not have caught your eye, happened about a year ago. Amazon entered into the ocean transport business. Amazon is expanding its operation so it doesn't just send items around the world, it ships them too. The retailer's Chinese subsidiary last January was awarded a license by the Federal Maritime Commission, as you heard, to operate as an ocean freight forwarder or a non-vessel owning common carrier. That's marking the first step Amazon is making into this $350 billion ocean shipping market. And we all know what happens when Amazon steps in. In addition to shipping their own goods, because they're an NVOCC, Amazon China can legally be an ocean transport intermediary and allow itself to ship goods to the US by boat for other companies. The license is just half the battle for Amazon. It'll take months or a few years for this company to actually commence shipping operations, but the move makes sense, and it parallels what they're doing with planes and trucks. Ocean-bound shipping, as we know on the liner side, is cheap at the moment. And while the option may not mean much to sellers in the United States, imagine if you're a Chinese firm who can't shell out for your own shipping or expensive air shipping. Amazon can do it for you. As one article said, and I quote, ocean shipping might not be as flashy as drone deliveries, but it's a move by Amazon to stay on top of the game in an increasingly competitive market. Alibaba, which was also mentioned, is making inroads into the US, but Amazon's move could undercut the China retail behemoth, allowing manufacturers to sell directly to American consumers without a tortured delivery process. And that gets me back to efficiency. It's in the software and the logistics that we need to make improvements in the global shipping industry, not the hardware. But that isn't where I see the industry concentrating their efforts. We're still concentrating on the hardware, the ships that are hugely capital intensive. In tankers, we talk about eco ships and powering them with LNG. In bulkers, it's Valley Maxes, as well as eco ships. Don't you still have some, Robert, or is he gone? In liner companies, bigger is better with 15 to 20,000 TEU vessels. And we still have an outdated broker network, John Hans in the room, that's inefficient, but profitable. Did anyone notice what shipping stock hit a 52-week high today? It was Clarkson. Now with a market cap of $1 billion. So don't tell me software doesn't have value. But don't tell me it can't be disrupted either. So I don't think we're looking in the right places for efficiency. Again, I agree with Martin, who says the challenge is to change a transport system which, using a 19th century neoclassical model, is poor for the needs of the 21st century transport market. But lest you think I'm too negative, let me bring you back to the present. The trend is our friend in terms of shipping cycles. The FTC I mentioned earlier, we will regress back up to the mean from where we are today, which is well below the mean. And we all know that ship ordering is down and demand is growing. Shipyards are not overly discounting to get orders. And why is that? It isn't because the banks won't let them do it, in my opinion. It's because it won't make a difference. We still have too much capacity and people aren't going to order. So the financial returns are poor and it's hard to attract new capital to the sector. In my opinion, that's good and necessary. When we have too much capital thrown at this sector, the returns go down. And we all know investors were burned and ships are being scrapped well before their physical life. This is a function of a few factors, but every single one is disturbing. So in my opinion, let's starve the industry of capital and let returns go up. And that's something in the last few years at Teekay we did. When we went out to buy tankers, we bought on the water tankers. We didn't order them. But when will returns go up? I'm not sure there will be as much speculation in this industry as there has been in the past. Folks have been burned and they're concerned with the disruptive technology I've been talking about. Instead, investors are going to wait until they see real growth before investing. Better to come a little late than too early. And what about all this financial speculation in shipping? Is it good for the long-term fundamental and industry returns? I would argue no. It inherently creates short-termism, and building transport systems that are sustainable and efficient are not a product of speculative finance. When I was a banker, and so this is 15 years ago, I had a ship owner who said to me, operating a ship is something terrible I do between buying it and selling it. I think that speculation in fixed assets is on its way out. Instead, I think the future is about building transport systems that are sustainable and efficient. And I think this will happen in the future, just as it's happening in land transport. We may even get driverless ships. The classification societies like DNV are already showing the way. But it's going to take a different model, one that will involve integrated systems, big data, using technology to eliminate these inefficiencies in the transport system. And it's going to go back to the 50s of involving cargo owners with shipping companies in a more cooperative way. Think Apple and Foxconn. If the industry does this right, we will have a beautiful fleet of smart ships talking with cargo customers as well as competitors, something that the alliances don't do, integrated fleet management, and much higher utilization. So I see a future for shipping that's a positive one. So that's some food for thought while you put some food in your stomach. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. Very eloquently said. Thank you very much. And now we go to the great insight and very well delivered, as always. So now we go to recognizing Richard Moulin. Again, that's another person who needs no introduction, but if you allow me, I will take a moment just to share my own memories, if you want. I know Richard for a very long time. We actually met for the first time in 1981. By the way, if you are trying to wonder how old I am, I just turned 41. So we met back in 1981. I was at the time the president of the International Shipping Club at Harvard Business School. And we were trying to put together interesting programs and invite leaders in the industry and former graduates. And Richard was the very first person who came to the club to make a presentation to the MBA students. And since then, our friendship has, of course, developed. And I have to say that today, Lambros put together from Lloyd's List, put together a very nice article on Richard. And what he stressed is what I also am an admirer of, not only his industry presence, his industry acumen, but also his humanitarian work. And we all know, Richard, that he has been a contributor to the industry and to our community in many ways. He's been with Seamus Church, he's been the chairman of INTERTANKO. I mean, I'm not going to go down to CV. Sonde is going to actually formally introduce him. But I just wanted to say that I, as Nicholas, I'm particularly honored and privileged and moved, frankly, to have the opportunity to call him not only my friend, but to be able to pay my respects to him publicly. And in closing, I'd like to say, a few years ago, we started a new conference in London on a topic that everybody thought was very exotic. It was corporate social responsibility in shipping. A number of people I talked to, they were saying, are you kidding us? I mean, what is this? What does it mean? Richard was the one who came and said, that's a great topic, it's a great subject, I will help you put it together. He actually single-handedly helped me invite speakers. He came to London himself. He said, Nicholas, that's your personal CSR, because you will never make money out of that conference, but it's a great idea, it contributes to the industry, and I will help you to put it together. And that's really one of the many elements that I admire in Richard. Anyway, and now I will ask Sonde. Again, we are absolutely privileged to have Sonde with us today. You all know him, an amazing industry presence, and he's going to introduce Richard. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon. It's my privilege and pleasure to introduce my very good friend, Richard Moulin, to you today as the 2017 recipient of the Capital Link Shipping Leadership Award. Now, there are very few of us in the shipping industry who've covered the waterfront quite as broadly as Rich has. He's not only had a very successful career in the shipping industry, he also has a lifetime of yacht racing behind him. In fact, he virtually grew up in the water, and he sailed successfully in most of the major ocean yacht races in the world, including the Transatlantic, the Fastnet, the Sydney Hobart. He's represented the US in the America's Cup. He's won the double-handed Newport to Bermuda multiple times, and he holds the world sailing record for sailing non-stop, double-handed, from Hong Kong to New York. Think about that a little bit, sailing non-stop, double-handed, from Hong Kong to New York. And he did that in his 40s, which I think is quite remarkable. And I remember helping to arrange some help off the South African coast if he needed it. It was all went swimmingly. He also once served as an officer in the US Navy, and of course he spent his career in the shipping industry. Having successfully risen through the ranks at RMI after graduating from Harvard Business School, and he subsequently became the CEO of Marine Transport Lines. After selling that company, he founded Intrepid Shipping, becoming a ship owner himself to crown his career, and he continues to run Intrepid as a ship owning company to this day. As if all that wasn't enough, he also served successfully as chairman of INTERTANKO for 3 years. He's served on the board of Siemens Church Institute for so many years, I can't remember how long it is now, and he's currently its chairman. He's been widely honored by our industry already. He has received the US Coast Guard Distinguished Service Award, the Admiral of the Ocean Seas Award, and Commodore of Connecticut Maritime Association. He's also director of 3 public shipping companies, and most important of all, one of them is Teekay Tankers. I've been very fortunate to know Rich for the past 30 years, and we've enjoyed many adventures together. I remember well a very rough passage we had once back from Bermuda on his 36-foot sloop, where we got flattened by a squall we didn't see coming at 4 o'clock in the morning. And Rich was both cool, calm, competent as we got the yacht back upright. He really is one of the coolest skippers I've ever sailed with, which makes it fun. We also sailed together in many races in the former America's Cup 12-meter boats in Long Island Sound. And it's especially good to sail with Rich because you always win. Rich is somebody who's accomplished a great deal in our industry. But more important, as you heard a little bit earlier, he's given back so much as well, which I think is critically important. In my view, nobody is more deserving of the Capital Shipping Leadership Award than Rich. Congratulations.
Sean, for that introduction and for being my shipmate on that trip back from Bermuda. I've also been thrilled to serve on one of your boards. More important than anything else was coming back from Bermuda in the gale. I found out that Sean really is a mariner. He didn't get seasick. And for those of you who are investors in Teekay, Sean was chairman for 18 years till recently just retired. It's good to know that the chairman of such a group of companies is actually a real mariner. And Sean is a real mariner and a great friend. Now, perhaps the bumpy ride in the shipping industry has tested some of your stomachs also. I'm pleased to also share the podium with my friend Peter Evensen, also on the Teekay Tanker board, and congratulations for his leadership at Teekay during his years there, too. Between Sean and Peter, they built what I think is the greatest group of companies, public companies, in the shipping industry, and they have terrific standards for corporate governance, which I'll come back to later. Sean, Peter, and I also share the fact that we were all honored as Commodores of the Connecticut Maritime Association. As the oldest, I was first, and that's good because I now present the awards and get the last word in each time. And particularly with Peter, it's always good to be able to get the last word in. Once I told Peter that in 10 minutes I could teach him everything I knew about shipping, and in 11 minutes, everything we both know about shipping. Now, when I started shipping in 1974, you would have been hard-pressed to imagine our shipping leaders spending a day with public and private investors. Can you visualize Aristotle and Assis sharing this corporate strategy and innermost secrets? Or how about the other golden Greeks or Norse gods or Hong Kong moguls reporting to their public company boards, especially their audit committees? But thanks to Nicholas and his team at Capital Inc., we have this great conference where members of the financial and shipping communities can exchange information. As investors or advisors, your primary objective is to find and analyze investment opportunities in the shipping industry. During my career, this has also been my primary objective, But there are two significant differences. First difference, for better or worse, I am a shipping executive, a ship owner. I can lighten up by selling or chartering out my ships. I can dig in by purchasing ships or trading spot. But outside my IRAs, my house and my sailboat, all my main assets are in shipping. For you, with an almost infinite menu of investment choices, shipping is probably one of your most challenging ones, full of risk and opportunity. The only comfort is that shipping is 5,000 years old and not going away, but your time horizon is not measured in centuries. The second difference, every day I'm acutely aware of the hundreds of mariners serving on my ships and the thousands on Teekay, Tidewater, and Pangaea vessels, my other boards. As chairman of the Seamus Church Institute, I'm involved in their work to serve and protect millions of mariners at sea on any given day. There's one message I'd like to leave with you today. Behind your investments, behind the companies here today, are hardworking professional mariners, men and women, who every day are at sea, far from their families, in circumstances that range from boring to high risk. A great sailor once described going to sea as long periods of boredom punctuated by moments of terror. Many of you are wondering, why is he telling us all this? What does it mean to my or your professional responsibility? What does he expect me to do about it? Well, here's an observation. A shipping company has two constituencies who are remote and often unseen, mariners at sea and public shareholders, who are sometimes left at sea. From my observations of public and private companies the past 43 years, whether as chairman of INTERTANKO, the world's leading tanker organization, or chairman of Seamen Church Institute, the companies that take good care of their crew also tend to take good care of their shareholders and shareholder responsibilities. Good governance is not a random event. I'll repeat that, good governance is not a random event. I would like to think that your due diligence of shipping companies goes beyond analyzing numbers only, that you would examine their vessel operations, safety records, and treatment of mariners. I would encourage you to support the nonprofit organizations, and I don't mean the shipping companies that are not making money. The nonprofit organizations that provide mariner services, such as port hospitality, visiting chaplains, legal defense, Christmas at sea gifts, supportive families, and anti-piracy and maritime safety lobbying. Some of the lead organizations helping mariners include, and I'll name two, Seamus Church Institute of New York, New Jersey, and the Coast Guard Foundation. Last year, the Seamus Church administered the El Faro Relief Fund for the families of the 28 American and 5 Polish mariners who were lost when the U.S. flag El Faro went down with all hands. The Coast Guard Foundation helps the families of Coast Guard men and women, including those lost trying to save lives at sea. There are other good organizations, and I'm sure Capital Link can provide leads if you're interested. For Seamus Church, I'll do a little advertising. Our big Silver Bell Gala dinner, June 8th in New York, is the largest dinner in the shipping industry in the United States. It's a lot of fun. And we host a mountain challenge sponsored by Cargill in the mountains of Maine in late September for any teams that want to join us. To wrap up my remarks, I thank Nicholas and Capital Link for this very nice recognition today, and Sean for his introduction. I will leave you one final thought. We all use the word venture as in venture capital. It is derived from adventure, which the first great maritime traders and ship owners, the Phoenicians, used to describe an ocean voyage. It was an adventure involving a joint risk taking by the cargo owner, investors, bankers, the ship owner, the captain and his crew, and nothing has changed since then. Thank you. Wanted to ask me one question, so I prepared a few additional notes.
So before we present you with the award, Richard, I wanted to ask and go back to Commissioner Cordero, to Peter Evensen. They both talked about providing efficient and safe transportation. On the other hand, we have, we are in an industry that is public, cyclical, and we talk about timing of the asset acquisitions as a primary consideration for generating good returns. So how do we put it together?
It's a good question. If you didn't hear, it's how do you put together the ideas that shipping companies are there to provide a service, but you're in such a challenging environment in terms of cyclicality to do it. What is the what do I think about this? And I thought back a bit to when I was chairman of INTERTANKO, which Nikos Strakos now is doing a great job helping the industry. Now, we tried to figure it out. We had more than 55 minutes to do it. We only figured out parts of it over a three-year period. But one comparison we eventually came to is aviation versus maritime shipping. And in aviation, you have a fragmented, you have only two great producers of the aircraft, Boeing and Airbus. You have smaller companies out there, but you have huge concentration in the providers of the assets. And those two big companies have a real stake in how their customers do. In shipbuilding, it's wildly fragmented, and when your ship leaves the yard, you're challenged even to get your guarantee claims honored by the shipyards. Luckily, the ships are really good quality, but the fact is the industry is fragmented. So here in shipping, you have a fragmented industry, all trying to build as much as they can, and you have ship owners through the cycles trying to make a living and provide a service. You also have sometimes too much enthusiasm, like when the eco bulge occurred in 2010, we were just recovering from the financial crisis, and a lot of ships got ordered on the with the excitement that there was an improvement in engine performance and fuel consumption, which is true, but at that moment we didn't need more ships. The good side is the underlying power in our business is the growth of world trade. And you go back to thousands of years, you can see it ramping up, and in recent years it's been very strong. You have ups and downs to certain commodities, but the net-net is the world's more connected, as Tom Friedman might say, and that the only efficient way to move anything that's big by weight or volume is on a ship. And Einstein could have told you the reason is one word, buoyancy. Very cheap to float big, heavy objects and then just push them with the use of a turning propeller. Airplanes will never do it. So we have a great advantage that shipping's essential, it's going to be here forever, and it's connecting a world that's more interconnected. But given the volatility and the propensity to build too many ships, I think what we've developed is two alternative strategies. And neither one is a loser or a winner necessarily in the stock market. Both can be executed, but you ought to know what you're getting into before you buy the shares. I call one the timing or the asset play. And I'm being purist when I kind of shove them into two categories. But here, when you buy a share in a company that's trying to time the market, you're betting on two different timings. You're betting on the management of that company to be able to time the market, and your ability to time when you buy and sell the shares. And huge losses and gains can be made. It's an exciting way to make a living. What I think people find out is when money's available, it's very easy to buy things, very easy to order ships, very easy to buy ships. But it takes a lot more time to sell them. And psychologically, it's very hard to sell while the market's running up. Typically, people try to sell when they get the first sniff that the market's turning down, and it's too late. So the asset play, the timing play, can be very powerful. It's not going to go away because shipping's cyclical, but it is definitely one style of investing. The other, we call the transportation service, which the other speakers both talked about. And there, you've got company strategy oriented to providing a service, close to their customers, strong market share, like the container ship industry is going into now, providing very specific services that your company is competent at, very intense and safe operations, both on the ships and in the ports, trying to get very high utilization of the assets, whether it's the ships, whether it's the port facilities, the square footage on the ground. Ship design and port design are all important. This is what transportation service is about, but you can't do it without a little eye on the timing side. So you can't time a business like this perfectly. You have to have continuous capital investment, but there's times to wait the investments to a higher level when shipbuilding prices are cheap, and there's a time to go a little lighter when things tend to run away. So these are kind of the two styles of doing it. And if I named a few companies who are doing the transportation service, one great one is Kirby. Kirby's doing it on the U.S. waterways. Teekay is doing it in its sectors. Maersk does it. Pacific Basin does it. These are companies that focus in their areas and try to provide a service. There are others. Not always successful, you know, because prices go up and down in the stock market. But in the long run, these are the companies doing the services. On the asset play, there's a lot of companies. Some do it very well, some don't. Some have good governance, some do not. But realize when you're in that market, there's two timings going on, management's timing and your timing with the shares. And that can get pretty exciting. But that's what I want to thank you, Nicholas. Thank you.
So let's go.